All right, shall we get started? People will trickle in. Today, we'll finish up what we started last time, which is memory interference, and then we'll go on to latency tolerance, which is another exciting topic. You looked at some latency tolerance mechanisms, but we'll start with run-ahead execution, which is actually very interesting to me. This was my PhD thesis, and we'll continue on with prefetching. But this is actually a prefetching mechanism, too. Okay, well, you know that there's homework, there is the lab, which hopefully you're almost done with. What? What lab? This is the lab, right? This should be fun. You'll do prefetching. If you want to, you can actually do run-ahead execution, but that will be a little bit tougher than regular prefetching. But I challenge you to do that after this lecture. And there is a midterm next week, which is actually the earliest deadline. So it's important to do the homework for the midterm. OK, last lecture, we've covered a lot. We mainly focused on memory interference and techniques to manage it, with a focus on memory request scheduling, as you remember. We looked at memory performance hogs, looked at many different techniques to do quality of service aware memory request scheduling, stall time fair memory scheduling, parallelism over batch scheduling, thread cluster memory scheduling, as well as ATLAS, adapter per thread, least attained service scheduling. And the principles, hopefully you remember, on all of those. And these principles are actually applicable beyond memory request scheduling. So wherever you may see similar problems, you may think of applying some of these principles, like least attained service scheduling, to get high throughput, high performance, or clustering threads into multiple different groups and handling them separately to get both performance as well as fairness. You could do that, for example, in disk scheduling as well. As far as I know, there are no techniques that have been developed for that purpose, but you can think of doing this. At the operating system level as well, operating systems can, actually, many operating systems cluster threads into different groups based on their interactiveness, right? If you look at Linux, you have a batch of threads that are interactive versus non-interactive, and different policies are employed for scheduling those different threads because they have different requirements. Interactive, you would like to make the user happy. Non-interactive, you would like to achieve high throughput, as well as some fairness for those jobs, right? So TCM operates similarly to those principles, except it's specialized for memory scheduling, right? And devil's in the details, of course. Whenever you design a scheduling mechanism, you cannot just say interactive versus non-interactive. And the question is, how do you actually identify those threads to be latency sensitive versus bandwidth sensitive, as TCM does? So you need a very concrete mechanism at the memory scheduling level. So a lot of the schedulers may be similar in their goals as well as how they achieve those goals at the high level, but the low level implementations need to be different because they're targeting different systems to schedule to, right? Okay, we've looked at memory channel partitioning, which is another approach to provide fairness, separate threads that are interacting badly, or source throttling, which is another approach, and co-scheduling of threads, which we did not go into a lot of detail in co-scheduling, but you can imagine putting threads that interact well together or scheduling threads that interact nicely with each other at the same time, whereas not scheduling threads that destroy each other's performance in memory not at the same time. You basically stagger those threads' execution. And we briefly talked about memory scheduling for parallel applications. If you can identify the bottleneck thread, the thread that's on the critical path, for example, the thread that's preventing the progress of many other threads because it's holding a critical lock, maybe you would like to prioritize that thread over other threads, right, in the memory system. And maybe in general, in other resources as well. Or maybe you'd like to accelerate that thread such that it gets out of the way quickly. So these are a lot of general principles that we've discussed in the last lecture. Today, we'll start memory latency
Yes? I have a question. So if you use a NUMA system, is the memory interference still a big issue?
If you use a NUMA system. So a NUMA system essentially partitions memory across different cores, right? Across different CPUs, let's say. You basically have some cores here and some memory here. Let's say memory 0. And then some other cores here and memory 1. You could still have interference here, right? So interference still happens here. And interference still happens here as well. So now the interference, the nature of interference may be a little bit different because these cores will be accessing this memory as well. So interference still remains. You cannot eliminate interference as long as there are multiple threads accessing some sort of memory. Whether NUMA or not NUMA, it doesn't matter. Make sense? Until you give each thread its private memory, you cannot get rid of interference. The question is, what level of interference do you have? Eventually, NUMA is, in a sense, orthogonal to multicore, right? If you want to scale a multicore system, at some point, you cannot put more cores, so you would like to put more chips, and you do non-uniform memory access. I guess I said this already early on, non-uniform memory access. And now, if these threads are accessing this memory, they're interfering with threads that are local to this memory, as well as other threads that are accessing this memory.
Okay. But those requests should be few, right?
That's right. But there's still interference within this local memory, from the cores that are local to this memory. Yes?
I think he's asking, what if you only have one core per partition?
Oh, OK, one core per partition. But then you've gotten rid of the problem, right? That memory interference. So basically what you're saying, in a sense, is one way of eliminating interference is you have a core and its own memory, let's say. And you have another core and its own memory. Right. And you're saying these cores do not communicate with each other. This core doesn't access.
They communicate with each other rarely because there's a higher cost associated with accessing the other core's memory.
I see. So the downside of this is now the communication latency is very high, right, between the cores. There are reasons for going having multiple cores on chip that share memory, which is you can communicate with much lower latency on chip. You don't need to go off chip. So you could certainly design a system like this, which will reduce interference, perhaps, because now this core has its own kind of local memory. But now it comes at the expense of additional latency for communication, additional bandwidth. Make sense? And also, there are other factors, right? You have a lot of transistors that are available for your chip. What do you do with the remaining area of this chip? Right. Maybe you design a smaller chip. That's a possibility. But there are downsides to that, too. Okay, that's a good question, though. So private memory, or almost private memory, leads to, or not sharing the memory across many cores causes other issues like latency and bandwidth between cores. Okay, in a sense, you can consider this even in a single core, even in a multi-core chip, right? You could think of partitioning memory more finely here, and assigning one bit for each core. Your bus could be one bit. Now, ignore the address buses. There's an issue there. But maybe you have 64 cores and one bit per core, right? Now your latency increases to memory for each core, right? It's a similar problem, you could imagine. But you may eliminate interference. But when you communicate, now you still need to interfere. OK? And also, you have a capacity problem, right? If once you partition the memory this way, what if this core needs more memory? Then it will need to access some other memory, and you will get the problem of interference again. So this is a fundamental problem. It's very hard to eliminate as long as you need more memory and you want to be efficient. OK, we'll start memory. Any other questions on this? OK, then let's start memory latency tolerance. We'll cover run-ahead execution, and I don't know if we'll get to prefetching, although run-ahead execution is a form of prefetching. We actually have some readings required. This is the first paper I wrote, actually. It should be fun to read, hopefully. And this is a paper on prefetching. And there are some optional papers. If you're interested, you can take a look. I guess before we start memory latency tolerance, I'd like to wrap up what we had. We've looked at handling interference in main memory, but interference is a problem in the entire memory system, right? If you look at the memory system, you have multiple cores that are actually sharing caches, that could be sharing some caches. They're also sharing the interconnect. They're sharing the memory controller. And threads request interfere in this entire memory system. Then the question is, in many of today's systems, which is changing, but threads share the memory system, but memory system doesn't distinguish between these different threads requests. For example, the FRFCFS scheduling policy, that's the problem we had with that policy. It didn't distinguish between different threads requests. And you have a quality of service problem because existing memory systems have control algorithms that are not aware of the threats. As a result, aggressive threats can deny service to others. For example, if you have a shared cache and you have two cores, one core has a very large working set. It's streaming through memory, and its working set doesn't fit in the cache. Maybe it needs a cache this big. And another core has great locality. Its working set is this much. And if it were running alone, it would just fit in the cache and run very nicely, right, with great performance. Now, when these two run together, because this has such a high memory access rate, as well as it doesn't fit in the cache, it doesn't have good locality, it may be, for example, streaming through an array, right, and accessing a huge array that just doesn't fit in the cache. It basically kicks out the blocks that are fetched by this core that may have great locality when it's running alone, but it doesn't generate a lot of requests frequently. As a result, this core may get 0% cache hit rate, even when it's running alone. And this core may also get 0% cache hit rate when it's running together with this one, this other application, even though it would have gotten 100% almost hit rate if it were running alone. So you have a problem with the cache also, right? Now, we did not look at this problem. We don't have enough time. But you can think of using some of the fundamental principles that we've discussed within the cache as well. Although cache is a little bit different, right? How it is stateful. Now you have state in the cache. Then how do you solve this problem? In today's systems, if you use the LRU policy, it's not aware of threads, right? Unaware of these different cores or threads. As a result, it will install the cache blocks coming from this core that's accessing this array. One option is to partition the cache, right? Such that this core accesses only its own cache, and it doesn't interfere with this cache. This is similar to memory channel partitioning, if you will. It's cache partitioning. Now you have a private cache. Now the problem is, what if there is another core that actually needs bigger space than this cache? What if you have two? What if you have another core which could have used the space in the cache, but it was allocated only a smaller cache? This is the problem with private versus shared caching. So people have developed mechanisms to actually dynamically partition the cache, somehow identify how much utility each cache block is providing to different threads, and assigning that many cache blocks to each thread. This is called utility-based cache partitioning. I'm not going to go into that right now, at least. And this is by Qureshi. You can take a look at it. This is one way of having a shared cache, but dynamically allocating enough space in the cache. If a core benefits more from the cache, give more cache to that core. Right. Basically, allocate the next cache block or cache way to the core that benefits most from that cache block. And how can you do that? Well, if you draw this curve, let's say cache size versus misses, let's say, for different cores. For some applications, cache size doesn't matter, right? If it's a streaming application, if you don't have any locality, as the cache size increases, let's say from, I don't know, I call it one way, I don't know, maybe 32 kilobytes to 32 megabytes, let's say, your miss rate may be constant. You don't want to give any cache to this core, perhaps, right? Or maybe you give 32 kilobytes. I don't know. Depending on the knee of the curve, you start from zero. Whereas another application, let's say this, let's call this application A. An application B may have a curve like this, right? In this case, you would like to allocate all of your 32 megabyte cache to this application B, right? And there may be another application that has a different kind of curve, right? It may be that until you get to 16 megabytes, the miss rate doesn't change. But once you get to 16 megabytes, your miss rate reduces.
Why could this be?
Yes, the entire work is said just being cached.
Exactly, yeah. You may have a cyclic reference pattern. For example, let's look at it with four blocks. You may be able to house only four blocks in the cache, but your working set might be five blocks, right? Once you increase the cache size to five blocks, your cache miss rate becomes zero. But any time before that, your cache miss rate is 100%. Right? That's that kind of application. Your working set starts fitting here. So if you can determine the utility of each additional cache megabyte, let's say, or kilobyte, provided by the cache to each application, now you can make an intelligent decision. Whom should I give the next megabyte of cache to? Does that make sense? Then the question is, how do you actually determine these curves? But I'll let you figure out by looking at this paper. If we go into that paper, then we'll change the lecture to how do you do efficient caching in multicore. But this is an important problem whenever you share caches across different cores. If you don't do intelligent allocation of the cache, then you can get actually terrible performance. Very similar to main memory. And it's true for the interconnect also, right? Once you have an interconnect, for example, here, that connects the cores to different memory, for example, who gets that interconnect? You need to do scheduling there too. Okay, but existing memory systems, at least currently, they're improving now, do not do this. As a result, you can get bad performance. So we'll need to actually, how do you solve the problem? You know the answer now. Inter-thread interference is uncontrolled in the shared resources. We need to basically control it. You need to design interference-aware memory system. And this is one way of designing it, at least a cache that's interference-aware. But I'll give you actually two high-level ways of solving the problem. I'm not going to go into detail. We've looked at some of them. There are two general approaches to doing this. One is you can design the resources to be smart. And what are these resources? Again, you have the... I guess I can do this. You have the cache, shared interconnect, and shared memory. And you have a memory controller here. And in the interconnect, you can have routers, right? So you can design each of these resources to be smart, to have a configurable interference controller reduction mechanism. And we've seen some of these mechanisms in the memory controller, right? The thread cluster memory scheduling, for example, was an interference control reduction mechanism. And it was configurable. You could change the cluster threshold to trade off between fairness and performance. You could do the same thing for the cache. You could, for example, do utility-based cache partitioning or something else. And you could do the same thing for the interconnect, right? And you could design a quality of service mechanism for each and hope that when you put them together, it works fine, right? So that's one option to design a quality of service-aware memory system. And more often than not, it may not work fine, right? So, the other option is to keep the resources dumb. Dumb in the sense that you optimize the performance of each resource without necessarily being thread unaware. So you design the cache such that it has the most efficient caching policy without ignoring the threads. You design the memory controller such that it optimizes for memory bandwidth, let's say. But then, you control the interference by injection control or data mapping. Remember, this is the other approach, which is You have sources that are injecting to these resources. And you somehow figure out how they're interacting within these resources that are dumb and throttle the sources accordingly such that they don't destroy each other. This is the second fundamental approach, dumb resources. Resources are still kept dumb, but now you have intelligence in the periphery. And intelligence in the periphery actually is intelligence also in the mapping of the data. For example, you can keep the cache as LRU, but you can use page coloring. You remember page coloring? To partition the different sets across different threads. Right? Remember the operating system had control over which page actually goes to which set, right? Because of this. This is your virtual address, and this is your physical address. And operating system has control over this translation, the bits that change during this translation, physical frame number, virtual page number. And some of these bits actually determine your cache index, right? And the operating system can divide these bits that are taken for the index into colors and say, for example, indices 0000 should always belong to core 0. And indices 1111, or maybe the remaining indices 0001 to 1111 should belong to core 1. Now you effectively partition your cache at the operating system level. This is your resources dump. In a sense, it's not thread aware, but your operating system partitions that resource. That's one approach. You could actually do this in today's systems. You can go and change your operating system to do that. It should be fun. You can see the effect. Another approach, we've already talked about data mapping to memory controllers, right? That also keeps the memory controller dumb, if you will. It's not smart. It doesn't do thread aware memory scheduling, but you map the data to different channels such that threads do not interfere with each other. And we've seen that. And the last approach is the thread scheduling. You try to schedule threads such that they do not interact badly with each other. Of course, these approaches, if you look at the dumb resources, these have limited applicability, right? What if you have only 4 threads to run? Well, and they interact badly. Too bad, right? You don't have a choice in that case. And partitioning usually has the downside of now you may not be effectively utilizing your cache space. Right? And also, I'd encourage you to think about how you would change the partitions in this case. Let's say you're going into a phase. Your core is changing its phase such that it needs a little bit more cache. It's starting to benefit from that cache. How do you change the partitions that you give to that core at the operating system level? It's actually a lot of cost, because you need to change the virtual to physical page mapping and allocate more space to that core. Or distribute whatever you had mapped to these indices to many more indices. Now you need to move pages across in physical memory. Make sense? I'm running a little bit fast, but I'm giving you the high-level ideas, not the low-level details. Okay, so this is how you keep the resources dumb. These are two approaches. Smart versus dumb resources, and I'll give you a summary. We've seen actually examples of this. Smart resource was quality of service aware memory scheduling. This is another example of a smart resource. Source throttling, channel partitioning, thread scheduling are examples of dumb resources. Both approaches are actually effective in reducing interference, but there's no single best approach for all workloads. So some workloads like quality of service aware memory scheduling, some workloads are better off with partitioning. So it's best actually to combine these approaches. And I've given you one combination of that when we talked about memory channel partitioning, right? You integrate memory channel partitioning with scheduling. For some threads that are not very intensive, prioritize them in the memory scheduler. Everything else handled with memory channel partitioning. That's not necessarily the best mechanism, but that's one combination that performs better than either of these. And we've also seen several techniques, request scheduling, source throttling, and memory partitioning. And again, you may wonder what the results are. All approaches are actually effective in reducing interference, but again, there's no single best technique for all workloads. You cannot say, I'll just do memory request scheduling and I'll get the best performance. You get the best performance when you actually combine these things. scheduling and throttling, for example. And we already talked about one such combined approach. OK, any questions on this? So going forward, this has actually become even more important. Interference handling techniques will become more important because there will be more cores on chip. And memory bandwidth is not increasing. Actually, if you look at the rates, Moore's law is providing doubling the transistor count every 18 months, right? I guess you can draw that curve, 2x transistors every 18 months. Or you can say 2 years, doesn't matter. If you translate these transistors to cores, we're doubling the core count every 18 months. But the pin bandwidth is increasing by only 10% every 18 months or 2 years. Now you can make the math, right? You have a big memory bandwidth problem. So interference that happens at the memory bandwidth will become more important, as well as how efficiently you can keep data on chip becomes more important. So the managing the on-chip caches will become a lot more important going into the future. Now there's another angle to this, which is you don't necessarily want to move the data. What is very expensive in today's chips is actually the movement of data across these buses and the interconnect, especially out of the off-chip, moving data from off-chip to on-chip. That consumes a lot of energy. So you would like to minimize that, which also argues for managing your resources a lot better on-chip. And managing the resources a lot better requires better ways of managing the interference also. OK. No questions? So when you're designing future chips, think about this. When you're actually doing Lab 6, think about this also. Although you will be doing a single core version of Lab 6. If we had a Lab 8, that would have been a multi-core with cache coherence and interference mitigation mechanisms. But we don't have enough time in the semester. OK. Let's switch to another topic, which is also very important, latency tolerance. We've looked at out-of-order execution, right? And out-of-order execution's main benefit was latency tolerance. In fact, we talked about what if every instruction had a single cycle latency? Would out-of-order execution help? And the answer was no, right? And an out-of-order execution processor tolerates latency of these multi-cycle operations by executing independent operations concurrently. How did it do so? Just to jog your memory, it buffered instruction reservation stations and reorder buffer and picked instructions that are ready to execute from those reservation stations, right? And we had defined the instruction window as the anything that's needed. Well, instruction window is basically every instruction that's in the machine that is decoded but not yet retired, not yet committed. And every resource that's needed for that could be considered part of your instruction window, right? For example, the register file, the size of the register file that's needed for that, the size of the reorder buffer, the size of the reservation stations, the load store queues, right? That's also affected by how large your instruction window is. So what if an instruction takes 500 cycles? We had done this exercise earlier, right? How large of an instruction window do we need to continue decoding to tolerate this latency? And the answer is pretty large, right? If you have 500 cycle latency, if you don't want to stall, looks like we have other questions here. This looks actually interesting. Making alignment practical. That looks like DNA sequence alignment, huh? Which is also an important problem, but that's probably the subject of another lecture. OK, where were we? So we had this instruction window, and an instruction takes 500 cycles. And you're fetching 4 instructions per cycle, let's say. If you don't want to stall the instruction window, you need to fetch 2,000 instructions, right? You need to fetch and buffer 2,000 instructions. That's a lot of instructions, and that's a lot of hardware to tolerate that latency. So what is the problem? So we cannot build that large instruction window today with the power constraints. I'll assert that. You could actually build anything. Anything is almost implementable if you don't have any constraint. Right? But we have constraints in the design. So when a long latency instruction is not complete, it basically blocks retirement because we need to support precise exceptions, right? One option is you can say that this load is blocking retirement. Just get it out. But you cannot do that because we need precise exceptions in the machine. And reorder buffer provides that. And incoming instructions fill the instruction window, all of those structures that we've talked about. And once the window is full, the processor cannot place new instructions into the window. This is called a full window stall. It could occur because any one of these structures is full. You're trying to allocate a register, for example, and you don't have enough registers. You're trying to allocate a load buffer because you're trying to decode another load. And you don't have a load buffer available. And this full window stall prevents the processor from making progress in the execution of the program. Well, let me demonstrate this with an example. Let's say you have an 8-entry instruction window, a WIMPy one. I believe current processors have much larger windows, right? I was looking at the Haswell window. Is it 192 entries? 192. That's right. That's recently announced by Intel. It's a much larger window, 192. But this is a toy instruction window for you. 8 entries. You get a load. It takes hundreds of cycles. Let's say this branches depend on the load. It cannot execute, but it needs to be buffered. Let's say you have a bunch of instructions that are independent. Green means independent. You execute them. And the results are available. The results are done long before this load completes. But you cannot retire these instructions, because otherwise that would be out of order retirement, which we do not want. Now, if you have a younger instruction, because the instruction window is full, this load cannot be fetched and executed. But if you could fetch this instruction, maybe it will be a long latency cache miss, right? Maybe you really want to fetch this instruction because that's the instruction you want to execute, because that would overlap the latency of the load that you're waiting for. So a small instruction window eliminates your look ahead into the program to find independent instructions. And you cannot find this independent instruction because you don't have enough space in the machine. As a result, you cannot overlap the latency of this load that is stalled, that is an L2 miss. L2 cache miss. Whereas if you had one more space in your instruction window, you could have overlapped the latencies of two loads. Now, what happens when this load comes back? Now, you can retire the load, execute the branch, and retire all of these instructions, and fetch this instruction, only to figure out that this instruction caused a stall also, right? So it'll stall again. So that's why you need a large instruction window. And the processor stalls until the L2 miss is serviced to fetch this. I'll show you some data that showing that L2 cache misses are actually responsible for most full window stalls. And here's the data. This is simulation data, but if you actually do this on a real machine, you'll probably find this out as well. Of course, on memory intensive workloads. So if you look at this, this data is averaged across about 150 memory intensive benchmarks on a high-end x86 processor model, similar to Pentium 4 in 2002. These are traces that Intel used to design their processors at that time. They have a large trace set, and they run it through C-like simulators, just like the ones you're writing today in 447, to figure out what optimization should they do that would improve performance. And you could actually analyze those, how those traces would behave. So this is averaged across 150 traces with this kind of processor model, with a prefetcher as well. So if you look at the execution time of this average workload, it's stalling for most of its time, right? 68% of its time, you get a full window stall. And you have non-stall time, very little part of the time. And L2 misses are responsible for most of these. The question is, what can we do about this? Right? How do we tolerate stalls due to memory? Ideally, we don't want this, right? We want all of this to be compute, and we want the execution time to be much smaller. There are actually two major approaches and four fundamental techniques to achieve these. You can reduce or eliminate these stalls, or you can tolerate the effect of a stall when it happens. And we'll look at both of them. Actually, we've covered some of them so far. There are four fundamental techniques to achieve these, right? Caching basically tries to get rid of all of those stalls. Prefetching, multi-threading, and out-of-order execution. And we've covered caching, multi-threading, and out-of-order execution in detail. Prefetching, I've given you the basic ideas, but we'll see techniques for prefetching today, and specific techniques called run-ahead execution that kind of combines out-of-order execution and prefetching. And many techniques have been developed to make these four fundamental techniques more effective in tolerating latency. So let's take a look at these. Caching, actually, I should update the slide with the other paper that I mentioned, but you read Morris Wilkes' papers. These techniques were actually first developed in the 1960s, at least the basic ones. You know what caching is. It's very widely used. It's simple. It's effective. But when it doesn't work, it doesn't work. Right? If you don't have locality, it doesn't work. If you're streaming through memory, you will get stalls. Right? So there are advantages and disadvantages to all of these approaches, like everything else we've covered so far. Prefetching, that was introduced initially in IBM 360-91. So they had an instruction buffer. They would do sequential prefetching of instructions into that buffer. I believe they had an 8-entry instruction buffer. And that's a very simple prefetcher. Today, there are very sophisticated prefetchers, which we may get to in the next lecture. Prefetching usually works well for regular memory access patterns. So if you have a nice stride, if the processor is accessing A plus 6, A plus 12, A plus 18, the hardware can detect that relatively easily. And you guys can design that hardware for the extra credit portion of lab 6, right? Actually, it's not that hard. You can get the extra credit very quickly. You just need a stream detector like that. But it turns out prefetching for irregular patterns is very difficult. What if you're traversing a linked list? Or what if you're actually data dependent? You're searching keys in a dictionary, and the input is you're getting a lot of input, basically. And the input could be a bunch of words, right, that you're getting from the program. And you're trying to find if these words match some location in a book. You could construct a hash table that basically indexes the locations of each word in the book. And you could try to get the word, hash it into the hash table, and figure out which locations match to that word, right? If you look at this, this is kind of random access, because these words may have no pattern to them, right? You may be feeding words that are just random. And all of these accesses that you're doing to this hash table will be random in that case. Because, in fact, you actually probably have a randomizing hash function here that takes the word, hashes it to a bucket in the hash table, and then compares to locations, compares to the words that also hash to that bucket in the hash table. This is a very nicely random access benchmark. How do you prefetch for this? It's pretty tough. So that doesn't work for irregular patterns. Multithreading, again, we've seen this many times. It has many benefits, including latency tolerance. It works well for multiple threads, right? That's the upside. And people have actually developed mechanisms to use multithreading hardware to improve single thread performance. So can you take, and we will see some of this in the next lecture. You have a thread context. And what you can do is you can, in compiler, generate a pre-execution thread that prefetches for the main program. And you can run that pre-execution thread in the separate thread context. This way, you're running the main program as well as another thread that prefetches for the main program. And we may see this. And out-of-order execution, you've seen this also. This is actually the most effective method for tolerating irregular cache misses. You basically stall, and in the meantime, hopefully, you execute some load instructions that can uncover memory-level parallels. Right? You can parallelize independent cache misses. The downside is, as I've shown you, it requires extensive hardware resources for tolerating long latencies. If you have 500-cycle latency, you need a large window to uncover other cache misses or execute other instructions that can tolerate those cache misses. I say uncover other cache misses because If you look at the latency of a load instruction, this is 500 cycles, the latencies of other instructions are actually much shorter, usually 3 cycles, maybe 10 cycles, until you get a long latency load instruction. So you would really like to find other load instructions to overlap the latencies of, because it's hard to tolerate this latency with a bunch of ads, right? So the main benefit of out-of-order execution in tolerating latency is in finding those independent cache misses. So it requires extensive hardware resources for tolerating these latencies. So we'll look at a method called run-ahead execution that alleviates this problem. I guess it's not a later lecture anymore. The slide is misplaced, huh? Later lecture meaning the next slide. Okay, so what is run-ahead execution? I've already shown you this. So ideally, basically, we would like to keep the size of the instruction window small, but we would really like to also get this next load instruction that will enable us to overlap the latency of this first load instruction. Well, ideally, we may want a large instruction window. So what's the benefit of a large instruction window? If you actually change the instruction window size, this is the beauty of doing high-level simulation, right? In a C simulator, you can change the window size to 2048 entries and figure out what the execution time would be. That's actually essentially what we did here. You can do that once you build your high-level simulation, but this is very hard to do in Verilog. And you see that now your full window stall time reduced a lot, right? And a small fraction of it is due to L2 misses now. So you can, if you increase, made the window size 16 times larger here. By 16 times, you can reduce the full window stall time significantly. Now you're not stalling most of the time. And you also reduce the execution time significantly, right? By about 35%, maybe 32%. Make sense? So we'd like to achieve this benefit somehow without actually building this 2048 entry window, because that's huge. That's a lot of hardware cost. That's right, yeah, we don't want that. So run-ahead execution is a mechanism that keeps this while hopefully getting a lot of the performance benefit of this. But keep this slide in mind, we may get to it. So the problem is out-of-order execution requires large instruction windows to tolerate today's main memory latencies. And also as main memory latency increases, which is the trend in the future, it also increases because of interference that we've seen in the last lecture, right? Whenever you have interference, your memory latency increases. You have a bank conflict. The instruction window size should also increase to fully tolerate the latency. But building a large instruction window is actually very challenging, especially if you would like to achieve low power and energy consumption, short cycle time, and low design and verification complexity all at the same time. All of these go against a large window, right? If you have a large window, you need large reservation stations, large register files, large load store buffers. Well, that goes against your short cycle time, right? I guess you can keep your cycle time short by pipelining those structures, but now you lose IPC, instruction per cycle performance. Low power and energy consumption. Again, if you have a large instruction window, you need to search more structures, more of these reorder buffer entries, more of these reservation station entries. And complexity, I think it goes without saying. So scaling of this instruction window size is actually a major research issue in out-of-order execution. The question is, how do we achieve the benefits of a large window in a simpler way? Or put another way, how do we efficiently tolerate the memory latency with the machinery of out-of-order execution with a small window? And you've already seen the idea, memory-level parallelism, that enables tolerance of the latency, right? How can we get more memory-level parallelism with a small window? And that's the idea of run-ahead execution. It's actually a technique to obtain the memory-level parallelism benefits of a large instruction window. We don't want to get other latency tolerance benefits, because that requires building a large window. But can we achieve some of the memory-level parallelism benefits? And the idea is very simple. When the oldest instruction, this oldest load, is a long-latency cache miss, we're going to checkpoint the architectural state and enter a special mode, run-ahead mode. In this mode, instructions are speculatively executed. It's purely speculative. And the purpose of this execution, or pre-execution, is to generate prefetches. You go fast and figure out if there is an independent load instruction downstream. And if there's an independent load instruction, then you generate the cache misses. And if there are instructions that are dependent on cache misses or L2 misses, those instructions are marked with a special bit, invalid bit, bogus bit, and they're just dropped. We're not going to wait for them because their data will not be available for a long time, right? And we want to discover cache misses by just speeding through the program. And this mode ends when the original miss returns, the original miss that caused entry into this mode returns. At that point, the checkpoint is restored and normal execution resumes. And you start re-executing from that instruction that you threw away earlier. So you re-execute some instructions. That's the idea. But the hope is that once we get to those instructions that generated cache misses, you don't need to stall. So let's take a look at an example. What we ideally want is this perfect caches, right? All instructions hidden caches. It's always good to strive for that ideal. If you have a small instruction window machine, what happens is the processor computes for a while. It gets a cache miss. It computes a little bit more, and then it stalls because instruction window becomes full. And later on, the miss returns, and the processor can continue executing. But after a while, it gets a second load miss, and it stalls again after a while. With run-ahead execution, when the first load miss happens, and that becomes the oldest instruction in the window, we checkpoint the architectural state and go into the special mode. Instead of stalling, we keep executing instructions. Basically, this load instruction that we were waiting for, we're not going to wait for it again. We're going to throw it out of the machine because we've checkpointed the architectural state. We have a checkpoint of the register file. We're going to throw out this load instruction because we don't want to wait for it. Now we've created space in the instruction window for another instruction to come in. Now we can keep executing, right? And we throw the next instruction also, and then the next instruction, and then the next instruction. If the instruction is invalid, we throw it right away. If the instruction is not invalid, which means it's not waiting for a long latency cache miss, then we throw it after it's executed. So we have the values for that instruction. While in run-ahead mode, hopefully, you've executed far enough such that you get to this load 2, and you can execute it, and that generates a cache miss. Now, what run-ahead mode has done is it started this cache miss in parallel with this miss 2. This mode ends when load 1's miss returns. After that, the processor flushes its pipeline and restores a checkpoint that was taken here. And what is that checkpoint? That's the program counter as well as the register file. And restarts execution with load 1. So it re-executes this load 1. Now it hits because the miss was already serviced. And the processor continues computation. At some point, the second miss is done. And when the processor gets to load 2, that also hits because you've actually generated that load 2 miss much earlier than you would have if you had stalled here. This way, you can save cycles. So that's the idea. Instead of stalling, do some pre-execution and uncover those cache misses that would otherwise stall you in the future. So what are the benefits of this? Basically, that's what I said, right? Instead of stalling, you pre-execute these instructions, and the pre-executed loads and stores that are independent of L2 miss instructions, independent of this load miss, generate very accurate data prefetches. For both regular and irregular access patterns, as long as you get cache misses that are independent of other cache misses, you can compute the addresses, right? It doesn't matter if these are regular addresses or irregular addresses. For example, something like this would be captured by run-ahead execution because the words are independent of each other, and you could get to the loads that load the hash table entries corresponding to different words that are coming from an input, right? Okay. Also, instructions on the predicted program path are prefetched into the instruction cache. I also say trace cache here, which we did not cover, but you can think about that. As well, also branch predictor tables are trained using future access information. I'll let you think about this. If you have a hardware prefetcher, it's also trained. Now you're looking ahead into the future a little bit, right? You're running ahead. That's why it's called run ahead. This may or may not be a good thing, by the way, because you're going to go back to those instructions and re-execute them. So you may need to be a little bit careful. OK, any questions?
On the basic idea, Yes? What if the run ahead causes the previous cache to be evicted?
I see. So you may run ahead so far that something that you will need when you get back is evicted. That could be a problem if you run ahead very far. And I'll show you results that even if this effect is included, prefetching would benefit you. But you may think of more intelligent ways of handling that. You're right. Okay? So there are three things that you need to handle to implement a run-ahead processor. One is you should ensure that you can enter run-ahead mode. So how do you do that? You checkpoint the architectural register state. Right? How do you checkpoint the architectural state? Well, you can copy the register file somewhere, or you can copy the register alias table somewhere. Remember, we talked about the backend register alias table, right? This register alias table, or architectural register alias table. This register alias table is updated only at commit stage, and it gives you pointers to the register file for those architectural registers. You can checkpoint this and ensure that you don't deallocate those registers in the physical register file. That's a very simple way of checkpointing. And you can read the paper that you're assigned that discusses how to do this. So you can, there are many ways of doing the register file checkpointing. You can copy the entire registers, but that requires a data space to copy. Or you could copy the register alias table that's architectural and ensure that the architectural registers are not deallocated from the physical register file. Okay? Now let's look at instruction processing in run-ahead mode. Actually, I didn't tell you. This is for correctness reasons. For performance reasons, you may want to checkpoint other things, like the global history register and the return address stack. And the paper you're reading talks about those because you're going to go back and re-execute instructions, right? And if your global history register is messed up, changed, then you don't want to use that register because you'll get branch mispredictions. But you can read the paper for that. Okay, how do you process instructions in run-ahead mode? The instruction processing is very similar to what we have in an out-of-order machine, except for two key differences. One is it's purely speculative, right? And that's part of the beauty of it. The design can be relatively simple. If you build a very large instruction window, you need to verify that design to be correct. Whereas if you have a purely speculative mode where you ensure that the architectural state is not updated, software visible state is not updated at all, then verification is relatively easy. Right? You may be doing nothing in that mode. You may be generating random accesses, but you're never changing what's visible to the programmer. As a result, you're not hopefully making a mistake. As long as you ensure that you're not changing the architectural register state, you're fine. The second big difference is L2 misdependent instructions are identified and treated specially. The goal here is twofold. We want to remove them quickly from the instruction window such that we can make space for other instructions that we can fetch, right? That we can actually execute. And we don't want to trust their results, right? If this load doesn't have a result that's yet ready, we don't know the result. So we don't want to use that result to resolve a branch, for example, right? Because we don't have the data value. Okay? So there are two types of results that are produced, invalid and valid. Invalid means dependent on an L2 miss, or bogus. Some people call it bogus. Bogus results are marked using these bogus bits in the register file and the store buffer. And these values are not used for prefetching and branch resolution. Why? Because you don't have the value for that. Okay. So how do you remove instructions from the window? Again, that's very similar to an out-of-order machine. Whenever the instruction is the oldest instruction, it's examined for what I call pseudo-retirement. It's not retirement, because you're not updating the architectural state. It's like retirement. You're basically getting rid of the instruction from the window, and deallocating its resources, but you're not updating the architectural state. So if the instruction is invalid, bogus, it's removed from the window immediately, because you cannot execute that. You don't want to wait for it. If it's valid, it's removed when it completes execution. So you want to wait for it, because those are the instructions that may lead to some cache misses downstream. these instructions free their resources, which allows the processing of later instructions. So you have to free the register file entry, for example. Yes?
So if you mark a given load as invalid, and a whole bunch of instructions after that are dependent on that load, is it entirely possible then that this could just end up doing almost nothing, basically?
That's right. So that's a very good point. If all of the instructions are dependent on each other, then this is useless, right? Because you're not going to find any independent instructions. The hope is that there will be instructions that are independent. And that actually is a good question. There will be programs like you suggest. If all you're doing is a linked list traversal, then you may not find any benefit from this. Although it may be that at some point you may be doing a linked list traversal, but at some point you go to the outer portion of the loop and doing some other linked list. Right. Then you get to the outer portion of the loop. So this works because out-of-order execution works. Right? Out-of-order execution banks on having independent instructions. And this is also banking on having independent instructions. And if you look at some analyses, it turns out 70% of the instructions that are executed are actually independent of load misses. Yes?
Just continuing from that question, shouldn't you also have a limit to how far you can go? Because otherwise you might just be prefetching and then overriding stuff.
That's right. But that's the same question Jiao asked earlier also. There is a limit, right, which is when the load instruction that missed comes back.
No, but I mean, if you have a bunch of invalid instructions, then you might just go too far ahead, right?
I see. So I think now you're trying to make it more efficient. We'll get to that. That's right. There could be better ways of making these more efficient. I'm giving you the basic mechanism now. That's good. You guys are coming up with ways of making this more efficient, because efficiency is a problem, actually, with this. So one other thing that I will not go into detail, but the paper that you're going to read describes is, if you have a store that's pseudo-retired, you don't want to update the architectural state with it, right? But there may be later loads that need data from it. You're doing the store for a reason, perhaps. Well, hopefully, for a reason. So you do the store and place it into a location, and you would like later loads to access it. So we would like to communicate the store data to the load. So there can be a separate structure to do this. And a RENET processor provides a separate structure to do the store load communication. Make sense? You cannot do this through memory because you cannot put the store into memory. Right? You could do this through the cache and mark the store in a special way. Right? You can say, I've stored to this cache line, but it's actually a speculative store. It's not a real store. So don't make this cache line visible to everybody else, to the software. So there are multiple ways of doing this. But this is important because you're throwing away the store from the machine. And later, if a load needs it, this load may be later used by some other load that to generate an address that's missing the cache. If you forget the store, you may get a wrong address for this load. That's dependent on the store eventually. That's why you need a mechanism where pseudo-retired stores communicate their data to dependent loads. And, well, I guess I do describe that mechanism here. Basically, a pseudo-retired store writes its data and invalid status to a dedicated memory. It's called a RENHET cache. It's actually structured as a cache, but it doesn't cache data. It just keeps the stores that were pseudo-retired in run-ahead mode. The purpose is data communication through memory in run-ahead mode. And the dependent load, when it executes, reads this data from the run-ahead cache. So whenever you have a load, your data come from multiple, potentially multiple places now. So if you look at an out-of-order machine, when you schedule a load instruction, your data can come from the data cache, or it could come from the store buffer, right? Or now it could come from this run-ahead cache. Data cache contains the architectural memory state. This contains memory as it's retired, right? All the instructions that I've committed have updated data cache. RenAid cache contains memory state that is generated by pseudo-retired stores that are out of the machine, but pseudo-retired in run-ahead mode. And the store buffer contains, you can tell me, the memory state that are generated by the stores in the window currently, right? That are currently in the machine. Yes?
Wasn't there also a victim cache that stores the most recent victim cache?
That's right. But that could be here, right? You can consider this as part of your data cache. If you make it in parallel with the data cache, then it's over here. But usually, it may not be a good idea to make it in parallel with the data cache. That's a good point, though. Victim cache still keeps data that's committed to the architectural state. So basically, a load can get its data from these three different structures. And which one is prioritized? Let's say a load hits in all of these structures. Where should it get its data from? That sounds like a great exam question, by the way. I've already told you the ages of the stores that have updated this, right? You're in run-ahead mode. You're executing a load. It generates an address. You use the address to access these three structures. And these three structures always say, oh, I have that address. And I have that data. Which structure should the load get the data from then?
The store buffer,
right. Why?
Because it contains modifications that haven't been committed yet.
That's right.
So the run ahead node does not contain the most current information.
Exactly, yeah. So this contains the youngest instructions, right? Data generated by the youngest instructions. This contains the data generated by the next generation, the older generation. And this contains the architectural state. So if you enter run-ahead mode in a load, architectural state is here. So data cache reflects the state as if it was here. And this is our load, let's say load A here. And let's say these are the instructions that are in your window currently. The run-ahead cache contains the state of the instructions, data of the stores that were executed in run-ahead mode. Whereas the store buffer contains the state of the stores that are currently in the window. So if a load actually hits in all of these cases, that means that there was A that was produced here, and address A was stored to here, and address A was also stored to here. So you have a store here, you have a store here. The load should get its data from the latest of those stores, which actually happened to be in the machine because it sits in the store buffer. OK. So now you've stolen my exam question. Or I've given it away. OK. So a dependent load reads its data from the run-ahead cache. And if it doesn't hit in the run-ahead cache, if it doesn't hit in the store buffer, and if it hits in the run-ahead cache, then it gets its data from the run-ahead cache. If it doesn't hit anywhere here, but it hits here, then it gets data from the data cache. So the key thing is this run-ahead cache doesn't need to be correct, right? Because remember, we're in a speculative mode. Our whole purpose is just to prefetch. So the size of this can be small. One of the downsides of a large instruction window is we need a large store buffer, right? If you have a large instruction window, you'll have many stores in the window. But we don't want that large store buffer. If you're purely speculative in run-ahead mode, this can be relatively small. For example, if you actually miss, if you don't get that right, if you do not get this forwarding right, then all you lose is perhaps performance. And maybe not even that, because that data may not be useful later on. Because it may not lead to a load that actually misses in the cache. Right? OK. How do you handle branches in run-ahead mode? If you have an invalid branch, it's dependent on L2, it cannot be resolved, right? It's actually a problem in out-of-order machines also. Because you fetch this branch, you predicted it, and its data is not available yet, so you do not know which way it will go. You do not know if your prediction is correct. In a large instruction window, you cannot decide that. And if you have an invalid branch that's mispredicted, this causes the processor to stay on the wrong program path until the end of run-ahead execution, right? Because you have no way to correct that branch. Same problem with a large instruction window machine. And that's why if you're trying to build a large instruction window machine, branch prediction accuracy is very important. Valid branches, on the other hand, are resolved and initiate recovery if they're mispredicted, right? Because you have the data for those branches. And you can resolve them, and you can, within run-ahead mode, you can refetch. Okay, so what are the pros and cons of this? I've given you some of the advantages, but it turns out this generates very accurate prefetches for data and instructions at all cache levels, because it essentially follows a program path. It's simple to implement. Most of the hardware is already built in. It's already built into out-of-order execution, right? You just need to do the additional things that I've described to you. We haven't covered pre-execution-based prefetching mechanisms, but this is a little bit premature, but we'll look at that later on. But basically, you can think of this run-ahead mode as a separate thread that's executing, right? In a sense, it is a separate thread, right? We're assigning a separate context to it. That checkpoint is changing our context because we're going back to the old context by going to the checkpoint. What we're doing is you have this run-ahead mode that's executing when the main thread is stalled. Right? And the whole purpose of this run-ahead mode is to do prefetching. And I've already told you that there are some techniques where you generate a separate thread just to do prefetching. Now you don't need to construct that separate thread. The main program itself is used to prefetch for itself. Right? That's the idea. But you'll see this more clearly when we cover some of these mechanisms to do prefetching. What are the disadvantages? I think some of you already came up with several disadvantages. One is if you run too far ahead, you may kick out things from the cache that you will need later. Right? And that is a problem, although that's not as big of a problem as some other disadvantages. Inefficiency is one disadvantage, as one of you pointed out. It could be useless, right? And that's actually a disadvantage, especially because you're executing all these instructions. And if you're not gaining benefit, it's a waste. So we'll try to fix that problem. It's limited by branch prediction accuracy, as any large window machine is. It cannot prefetch dependent cache misses also. Right? If you're actually doing a linked list traversal, you cannot prefetch the next node. There may be solutions to this, though. Maybe you'll think of them. One of the reasons it could be useless is because its effectiveness is limited by memory level parallelism. If your misses, when you get a miss, if the next miss in the program is, I don't know, a million instructions later, and you need to execute a million instructions, that's not very useful, right? Because you're not going to execute a million instructions in 500 cycles to get to that miss. So if your memory level parallelism is not high in programs, you cannot get this. You cannot get much benefit. Now the good thing is it turns out a lot of programs are bursty when they generate misses. When you get to a cache miss, it's likely that you'll get to another cache miss soon. Can you imagine reasons for this? For example, one reason is you're changing the working set. You get to a cache miss, and that indicates that you're moving to some other block of data. For example, if you're, this is a very regular application, it's prefetchable, but if you're doing matrix multiplication, one way of getting good cache efficiency in matrix multiplication is to block the matrix. Right? Whenever you move on to a new block, you're changing your working set. So you're getting a lot of misses in that block, and then you're hitting in the cache. So you could cover a lot of those misses with run-ahead execution because they're clustered at the same time, around the same time. So a lot of programs exhibit this kind of property where misses are clustered together in over execution. And this takes advantage of that. But they also need to be independent, right? If they're dependent, then you have a problem. Okay, prefetch distance is limited by memory latency. Prefetch distance is how far ahead you can prefetch. And in this case, your memory latency is, let's say, 500 cycles. And if the instruction that you're going to execute and will generate cache misses is at 500 first cycle, well, too bad. You cannot get to it, right? Okay. So variants of this is actually implemented in IBM Power 6 and SunRock. Unfortunately, SunRock, I guess, doesn't exist anymore. It was a good design machine that couldn't go out before Sun died. But IBM Power 6 has mechanisms that are very similar to this. They actually have even more sophisticated mechanisms. They could do run-ahead on a separate thread context. If they had an SMT, they had a multi-threaded processor, and they could launch run-ahead mode in the separate thread context. So did SunRock. Okay, so what is the performance of this? I'll show you some results, and we'll take a break before you go into the enhancements. Let's see. I guess these are different workload suites. These, remember the 147, almost 150 workloads that I described to you? These are from different workload suites, SPEC, Standard Performance Evaluation Corporation workload suites. At the time, it was 1995 and 2000. Now they have a workload suite for 2006. Some web applications, some multimedia applications, some office productivity applications like Word and Excel, some server workloads, and some workstation workloads. Actually, the Verilog simulations you're running is one of the workloads that we have examined for this. And it turns out they speed up pretty well with run-ahead execution. I don't know if you want to have a run-ahead processor for your Verilog simulations, but oh, sorry. And this is the average across. So I show you four bars here. The first one is no prefetcher, no run-ahead. This is a terrible baseline. Don't ever use it. The second one is more interesting. It has a streaming prefetcher, aggressive streaming prefetcher that's similar to what's in Pentium 4. The third one is in only run-ahead without the prefetcher. And the fourth one is when you combine the prefetcher and run-ahead. So if you compare this red bar over the blue bar, and y-axis is microoperations per cycle, you get 22% performance improvement over only prefetcher. And only run-ahead actually provides better performance than only prefetcher in these workloads. So it's a better prefetching mechanism than the streaming prefetcher here. And you can see different workloads behave a little bit differently. Right? And I'll let you read the paper to look at the analysis. Then you can ask, how does this compare to large instruction windows? Right? That's where we started. We want a large instruction window. So the baseline was 128 entry window, and we added run-ahead on top of that. That's the red bar. It does better than, and we have three comparison points in addition, 256 entry window, 384 entry, and 512 entry window. It does significantly better than a 256 entry window, but it doesn't do as well as a 512 entry window. And it's within 1%, I believe, of the performance of a 384 entry window. So you can get almost the performance of a 3x the window with the resources of a 1x the window plus some deltas, right, additional deltas. And if you look at this, there are some cases where it's not even as good as a 256 entry window. And you can imagine why. That'll be my question in the next slide, probably. And there are some cases where it's much better than a 512 entry window. In fact, a 1024 entry window also. It could go both ways, right? Depends on your memory level parallelism. And depends on what other instructions you have.
Yes. What does microoperation refer to?
Oh, OK, microoperation. Remember, a long time ago, we've talked about you have complex instructions. And existing x86 processors translate those complex instructions to RISC-like operations. And microoperations are those. Basically, these are the internal operations that are not visible to the ISA, but that's the product of that translation from CISC to RISC operations. Okay. So run-ahead is not a real large window, right? It's using the resource of a small window to get the memory level parallelism or prefetching benefits of a large window. So there are obviously some differences. Then the question is, when is one beneficial and when is the other? What are the pros and cons of each? Well, I guess I'll give you a couple of these, but I'll let you think about it. In fact, the paper that you're reading has a good treatment of this. For example, in this case, for these floating point workloads, run-ahead doesn't do well as well as doubling the instruction window size. Doubling the instruction window size is good, especially for these workloads, because these workloads have long latency operations, like floating point operations, that are tens of cycles of latency. Run-ahead execution does nothing to tolerate those latencies, right? Whereas a large instruction window can tolerate any latency, because it can execute any operation and tolerate any latency. Whereas run-ahead execution is triggered when you have a cache miss, right? When you have a long latency cache miss. And you can tolerate only long latency cache misses because it's really a prefetching mechanism. It doesn't buffer the results of the instructions that are executed. Whereas a large instruction window buffers the results, and it uses them. Although there are some cases where a very, very large instruction window doesn't get as much benefit as run-ahead. So in this case, run-ahead actually can execute many more instructions than a large instruction window. That's why it can achieve more benefit. And it turns out that it can prefetch a lot of cache lines, cache blocks during that execution. OK, I'll let you think about this more, and the paper will hopefully give you some ideas. So this technique is not specific to out-of-order execution, right? I motivated this with out-of-order execution because that's the state of the art. But you could employ the same thing on an in-order machine. In fact, it may be even simpler on an in-order machine. Basically, you don't have the instruction window, but well, you still need a reorder buffer in an in-order machine because of multi-cycle operations that we discussed. But you don't do out-of-order execution, but you do in-order execution. And you can add run-ahead on top of that. And these show some results. What happens if you add run-ahead on top of an in-order machine with prefetching versus an out-of-order machine with prefetching? And this is what you would get. And in fact, many people have been very interested in, can you achieve the benefits of out-of-order execution while keeping the machine in order plus doing run-ahead when you get these long latency cache misses? And if you look at this, the performance improvement over an in-order machine is about 40%. Whereas the performance improvement on an out-of-order machine is 20% with run-ahead. Why is it much higher on an in-order machine? In-order machine has no tolerance to latency, right? So you cannot tolerate latencies at all. Whereas out-of-order machine can tolerate some of the memory latency with its instruction window. So there's benefit. But if you look at the difference here, you cannot get using run-ahead, you cannot get as close to out-of-order execution. OK, this is a slide from one of Sun's distinguished engineers in 2008. They called the scout execution, run-ahead execution. It's scouting, right? It's scouting in the program and try to figure out cache misses. And this is one slide from their talk. They looked at the L2 cache size here and normalized instructions per cycle here. And this curve shows the performance without run-ahead on their in-order machine and the performance with run-ahead on their in-order machine. And if you look at a machine with 512 kilobyte cache, they figured out that run-ahead execution provides 40% better performance. And these are workloads, commercial workloads that they were interested in, like transaction processing workloads that Sun was in the market for at the time. So the good thing is this is very similar to the value we had at that time. But it's just sheer luck, right? And one advantage of this kind of latency tolerance techniques is you can reduce the cache space you have. So if you look here, their workloads did not benefit too much from caching, although there was some benefit, as you can see, from the performance improvement with no scout. You can build a machine that has a 1 megabyte cache and run-ahead execution and get the performance of the machine that has no run-ahead execution but 8 megabyte cache. And now you can use those 7 megabyte cache space for more cores, perhaps, right? So you can make these different trade-offs with different latency tolerance mechanisms. And they, I guess, also looked at this design point where your cache size is about 4 megabytes. And with run-ahead, you can get the benefit of a 16 megabyte cache. OK. I guess let's take a break here. And in the break, what I would like to ask you to do is to fill out the feedback forms. So that will have another checkpoint on your feedback and compare to what you've written in the previous checkpoint. I'll give you 10 minutes to do that, and then we'll cover run-ahead enhancements real quickly. OK, I guess let's get started. We can take that discussion offline. OK, as you realize, there are some issues with the baseline run-ahead mechanism. It does provide performance, but there is a power efficiency issue. So we'll talk about some of the enhancements. So this is your required reading. But if you're interested in the enhancements, you can read these papers. I like these papers because I wrote them. It's fun to read them again. Although, going back, these are significantly better written than my first paper. So sorry if you will suffer through the first one a little bit. But you can read the topics version, which is much shorter, but it doesn't go into as much implementation detail. Okay, so there are three big issues, I think. There may be several others with the baseline runhead mechanism. One is energy inefficiency. Right? You can actually execute a large number of instructions speculatively without gaining any benefit, and I'll show you some data. So the goal is to make it efficient, and there are ways of doing this. The second is pointer-intensive applications. For them, this is relatively ineffective, right? If the next L2 miss is dependent on the previous one, how are you going to get that address? Well, maybe there are ways to do that. The third is any large instruction window machine suffers from, branch mispredictions. Right? You would like to minimize them, but runahead suffers from those irresolvable branch mispredictions in runahead mode. You can be on the wrong path forever until runahead mode ends. Well, I guess forever and until runahead mode ends doesn't go well, but until the end of the runahead mode. And there may be ways of actually recovering from them. I will not cover that, but I'll give you the basic idea. We call this wrong path events. And the basic idea is if you detect an anomaly in the execution that you can attribute to a branch misprediction, you use that as a hint saying that, oh, maybe I mispredicted a branch. You did not really resolve the branch, but you see an anomaly. And what could that anomaly be? That anomaly could be actually getting lots of mispredictions in a row. It turns out if you start getting lots of branch mispredictions, it's very likely that you mispredict a branch that's early on in the program. That's one anomaly. Another anomaly could be you get a null dereference on a load, basically a null pointer exception. Except it's not an exception because you're purely speculative. You're not going to handle it. But if a load actually generates an address that's null, it's very likely that you mispredict the branch early on. Well, even if you're not, then there's a bug in your program, right? So you might as well go back. So that's the idea of wrong path events. Are there events that we can monitor simply in the processor that are indicative of a branch misprediction that occurred in the past, but we have not resolved that branch yet? And that paper discusses those events. It's a fun area, actually. Later, other people have used such events to indicate the existence of a fault in the machine. So if you get a fault in the processor, they also lead to some anomalous events like this. And you can use that as an indicator and a predictor for those things. OK, what is the efficiency problem? This graph shows some workloads from Spec Suite. And the blue bar shows the increase in IPC with runahead instructions per cycle. And the red bar shows increase in executed instructions. On average, you get 22% performance increase by executing 27% additional instructions, which is perhaps not too bad. But if you look at some workloads, you get 5% performance benefit while you're executing 60% more instructions. And for some others, you get 0% performance benefit while executing almost 50% more instructions. Even when you look kind of efficient, you get a lot of benefits here in ART, which has a lot of memory level parallelism. But you're executing 235% more instructions. So it's relatively inefficient. We'd like to increase the efficiency. How do you increase efficiency? Basically, there are three kind of runahead periods that are not efficient, short ones, overlapping ones, and useless ones. I'll not go into detail, but the idea is to detect them and eliminate them. Whenever you design a system, you'd like to be efficient. So what is a short runahead period? I'll just show you with an example. You get this load miss, you enter runahead, and runahead mode ends very quickly. Well, let's say this is your previous runahead mode. You generate another miss here. You keep executing. Load 1 hits. This is the figure I showed you earlier. And you get to load 2 before that miss is complete. Now, if you're not intelligent, you'll enter runahead mode again, only to exit very quickly, right? Because the miss will end soon. So the idea is this second mode is not very useful, right? You don't make a lot of progress in the execution stream. So why not figure that out and eliminate that? And the downside of these short periods is it's less likely that they'll generate useful L2 misses. And they have high overhead because, remember, we are flushing the pipeline at the end of runahead, right, to go back and re-execute the instructions. And that has overhead. That's why it's red. So we'd like to minimize these useless or short run-ahead periods. And you can imagine ways of detecting them, and the paper that you recommended has ways. Overlapping run-ahead periods, two run-ahead periods that execute the same instructions. Why do these happen? You get load one, and load two is invalid in run-ahead mode because it's dependent, and you exit run-ahead mode, and then later on load one hits, and you execute load two, and it turns out it's a miss. This is the case of a dependent miss, right? And you enter run-ahead mode again. If you look at the second run-ahead mode, it executed lots of instructions that are overlapping with the first run-ahead mode, right? Now, they're not necessarily exactly the same execution because now you have one value available, right, to you. This load two's, load one's value is available to the instructions over here, and all of the instructions that were dependent on load one executed over here. So maybe you'll uncover some misses, but it's inefficient regardless. So how do you eliminate that? Well, you can figure out a very easy way of eliminating this, right? You somehow keep a counter of instructions that you've executed in the last run-ahead mode, and you don't enter run-ahead mode until you've executed more than that number of instructions. Okay, useless run-ahead periods. These periods do not result in prefetches for normal mode, and this is the most general case. You enter run-ahead mode, it's just useless. You don't generate another miss. They exist due to the lack of memory level parallelism. Yes?
I'm just going to say, going back for a minute, what exactly dictates when you exit run-ahead mode?
Oh, in the basic mechanism, you exit run-ahead mode when this miss that caused entry to run-ahead mode comes back.
Okay, because like here, you're exiting before the hit comes back. That was part of the
line. So miss comes back here, you exit, and then there's a flush penalty.
Oh, okay.
Because you need to restore the checkpoint, restart the flush the pipeline, restore the checkpoint, then refetch the instruction. That takes a while, right, to fill the pipeline. Okay. So these periods are useless because basically you don't have a miss that's generated while you're executing. And here these are more complicated to figure out, but you can read the paper. But the basic idea is you predict, as with most of the things that we do in computer architecture, right? You predict whether or not you'll have a cache miss in the run-ahead mode. That's it. And there are various kinds of predictors that you can do. You can do fine grain per load that causes run-ahead entry, and you enter run-ahead and you train that predictor, see if you have misses. Or you could do on a period basis, on more coarse grain predictors, but I'm not going into that detail. So if you do all of those things, in the end you can actually reduce the number of instructions to 6% instead of about 27% additional instructions due to run-ahead. And these bad cases also reduce a lot. For example, parser, it was executing 50% more instructions almost, now it's almost blip. Right, and without losing performance significantly. So you could actually design a much better run-ahead engine if you're a little bit intelligent about the speculation you do. Okay, building upon this, run-ahead mode is purely speculative. The goal is actually to find and generate cache misses that would otherwise stall execution later on, right? I'll give you some questions. I have some more things to cover. But how do we achieve this goal most efficiently and with the highest benefit? The idea is to find and execute only those instructions that will lead to cache misses. So it can be even more efficient than what I've described here. For example, actually, I did not talk about this, but you can floating point operations in run-ahead mode, those usually don't lead to cache misses because you don't normally use floating point registers to do address calculation, right? So you can eliminate a lot of the floating point operations. You can skip over them to be more efficient. There's one downside to that. What if your floating point operation determines your branch direction, right? In those cases, you may lose if your branches are mispredicted, right? So I'll let you brainstorm about how to do this more efficiently. How to find and execute only those instructions that will lead to cache misses. Right now, run-ahead execution is executing everything. Okay, let's look at the second limitation, which is actually very interesting, which is a very tough problem computer architects have tried to tackle for a long time. How do you actually make sure run-ahead works a little bit for pointer-intensive applications? So what's the problem? Problem is dependent cache misses. If load 2 that you get in run-ahead mode is dependent on load 1, you cannot compute its address, so it becomes invalid, and you exit run-ahead mode without generating the cache miss, and when load 1 completes, now you can actually compute the address of load 2, and it generates a miss, and you enter run-ahead mode again. So this is bad in two ways, because you cannot parallelize the misses, and you're inefficient, right? This is the overlapping period. It leads to wasted opportunity to improve performance and wasted energy. And you can do some ideal studies. This is another benefit of high-level simulation. You could actually say, oh, whenever I get a dependent load, I'm going to magically assume that it's a hit in the cache. Right? In the simulator, you can do that. And if you do that, you'll figure out, at least with the workloads that I've done the study with, I figured out that ThreadNet performance would improve by 25% if this limitation would ideally be overcome. That means that can we get some of that 25%? And I'll show you some methods. So the idea is, you've seen this idea, right? Whenever you have a dependency, one fundamental way of handling the dependency is to predict the value. Right? That's what we're going to do. We like to enable the parallelization of a dependent L2 cache miss with a low-cost mechanism, predict the value of an L2 miss pointer load. So if a load is loading a pointer, predict the value of it. So an address load is a load that loads an address into its destination register, which is later used to calculate the address of another load. Really, you would like to predict these loads in Threadnet mode, because those will lead to other loads that will generate. And you can read this paper for more detail. But if you can do this, what happens now is this load one miss is an address load because it's really producing an address that's later going to be used by this load two. You can predict its value. Now load two can execute. Now it can compute its address. It can generate its miss. Those misses will be serviced in parallel. Now load one hits. And if you've actually predicted the cache line correctly, not necessarily the exact word in the cache line, but the cache line correctly, load two also hits in the cache. And now you've saved a lot of cycles, and you've saved a lot of speculative instructions as well. So we would like to do this. And I'll give you the basic idea of one mechanism that we've devised to do it. I'll define the address value delta of a load instruction as this. AVD, effective address of the load minus the data value of the load. And this may sound like magic, but it turns out for some address loads, AVD is stable. Basically, you have the effective address minus data value. It's stable over different instances of execution. And you can imagine why. And you can, basically, for an address load, you can keep track of the AVDs. And if the AVD is stable, when a load is an L2 miss in Threadnet mode, this predictor is consulted. If the predictor returns a stable AVD for that load, the load value is predicted. And predicted value is essentially effective address minus predicted AVD, right? We basically reverse this. Because you know the effective address of the load, right? That load one miss that caused entry into Threadnet, you know the effective address. That's how we generated the miss. The problem is you don't know the data value. But if the AVD, if you know the AVD based on past executions, you can actually predict the value. Right? That's the idea. So why do these occur? Since we don't have much time, I won't ask you, but I'll tell you why. This occurs because of the regularity in the way data structures are allocated in memory and traversed. And I'll give you two examples. You don't need to worry about the terminology here right now. You can read the slides later on. But let's say you have a regularly allocated linked list like this. The first node is allocated at address A, next node at address A plus K, next node at address A plus 2K, next node address A plus 3K, dot, dot, dot. Let's take a look at the traversal of this linked list. Basically, this is a traversal address load that traverses. You do node equals node next. I'm sure everybody wrote a program like this. Right? Let's take a look at the execution history of this particular load instruction. It's effective address, data value, and let's compute its AVD. And remember, AVD is effective address minus data value. In the first execution, the first node, the effective address points to the node. The data value is the pointer to the next node, A plus K. And AVD is minus K. Right? In the next iteration, the effective address is the pointer to this node, A plus K, address of this node. The data value is the address of the next node, because you're loading the pointer to the next node, A plus 2K, and AVD is minus K. In the next iteration, the effective address is the address of this node, data value is the address of the next node, and AVD is minus K. So now you have a stable AVD. Okay. Yes?
How's this different?
So exactly, the detection mechanism is going to be very similar, right? The detection, you're basically detecting AVD. Although what you're getting at is, I think, you can actually detect this by looking at the striding data value, right? You have a stride predictor that can detect this as well. So you don't need to use an AVD predictor for this one, but I'll give you another mechanism where you cannot use a stride predictor. So basically, if you can keep track of the AVDs or the stride in the data value, you can predict the data values produced by this load. Even though, and then you can actually generate the cache misses, dependent cache misses, right? Because you predict the values. That's pretty cool, right? You can generate cache misses even though instructions are dependent on each other, because you're exploiting this regularity in the allocation. So let's take a look at a harder case for stride predictors. This is actually from a real example from Parser. In Parser, you have nodes that point to strings, and string and node are allocated consecutively. It's basically a dictionary. You give it words, and it parses them. And it tells you if they exist in the dictionary. So you allocate a string, and then you allocate the node. And then you allocate the string, and you allocate the node. And because you're doing this allocation regularly, when you allocate the string, it's allocated at some address, and the node is allocated at address plus k, because the string happens to occupy k bytes, let's say. And same here. And same here. Now you have a constant delta between the node and the string, if you look at this. And then you scramble the dictionary. Dictionary is sorted, and build this binary tree. Now if you look at this in this binary tree, the nodes themselves have no correlation with each other in terms of address, but the string and the node that's associated with it have a correlation, which is they're k bytes apart from each other. And if you do the dictionary lookup for an input word, you have a leaf address load that does this. It basically loads the string, that pointer to string. And let's take a look at the execution of this traversal, just this load that loads the string. Basically, you do a node string. In the first node, effective address is the address of the node, a plus k. The data value is the address of the string, a. So your AVD is k. In the next iteration, let's say you went to c plus k, this node. The binary search took you there. The effective address of this load instruction is c plus k, the address of the node. The data value is the address of the string, and AVD is k. In the next iteration, let's say your binary search took you here. The effective address is the address of the node, f plus k. And the data value is the address of the string, f. Now your AVD is constant, stable, for this load. But data value has no pattern, right? There's no stride. So this is one example where a stride predictor cannot capture the data value. And you could imagine building a stride predictor, as we've discussed earlier. Instead of doing it for addresses, you do it for the data value. Make sense? It's fun, right? Of course, if your memory allocator is randomly allocating, whenever you ask for a memory to be allocated and the memory allocator is giving you random locations, this won't work, right? So your memory allocator